Most Holy Father, I appeal to you for aid. I served until recently as Archdeacon of Salona. In that office, it was my duty to communicate with your predecessor of holy memory concerning the excesses of my Lord Bishop, Natalis. He was and is much given to feasting, devotes scant time to reading of scripture, and appears totally unfamiliar with the ordinary conduct of the life of the church. More than this, I reported that you appropriated certain holy articles, relics and reliquaries, vestments, and some other sacred vessels, and distributed them to his friends and relatives as if they were so many trinkets. In response to this, my Lord Bishop Natalis has deposed me from the diaconate and the archdeaconry under the guise of promoting me to the presbyterate and installing me in a parish, which has the effect of house arrest, as the canons forbid me, now that I am a presbyter, to leave my cure without the bishop's consent, which he has no intent to grant. And he has appointed another deacon, one more friendly to him, in my place. I appeal to you, therefore, as I did to your predecessor of holy memory, to call upon Bishop Natalis to restore me to my former office and to urge him to reform his manner of life in a way more conformable to the gospel.
My dear, dear brother Shepherd of Pontus, it is with great joy I communicate to you my unvarnished thanks to Almighty God for your promotion to the See of Peter, to the Patriarchy of the Holy Church of Rome. God be praised. It is personally gratifying to me, as Metropolitan of this trifling little see of Dalmatia, to know that one so able and gifted in administration should at last find such an appropriate, how shall I say, scope for the exercise of his many talents in the mother see of the whole church. God grant you many years of faithful service in this highest office, and all the advantages of prayer appertaining thereunto. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Know what I mean? You have no doubt received the complaints of a certain troublesome presbyter, Honoratus, formerly my archdeacon, now promoted to presbyter, in a cure where he, too, can better exercise his pastoral gifts in a more intentional manner. He has great zeal, and as I have heard it said of your excellency, if the tales are true, a pious and ascetical spirit, much devoted to purity and simplicity. My hope all along has been that in his position as a presbyter, he might find the narrowness of his parish to be a more suitable context for the life of discipline to which he aspires and to which he is ideally suited.
My brother, bishop, and pastor, we have received the letter of your reverence wherein you congratulate us on our promotion. What you offer with kindness and earnestness of charity demands full credence, reason having prompted your pontifical self to rejoice with us. Being cheered by your greeting, I must testify that I undertook this burden with a sick heart. But seeing that I could not resist the divine decrees, I have recovered a more cheerful frame of mind. That being said, your report concerning Honoratus is full of non-sequiturs. Seeing that he is simultaneously advanced to the priesthood against his will and removed from the diaconate as though unworthy of it, a very strange proceeding indeed, for one unworthy of a humble office ought not to be found worthy of one higher. Furthermore, No one should be advanced by compulsion, nor should one who is innocent be deposed. And it seems you have done the same to the same one. And this done, so that you might appoint another complicit with your lifestyle, the aforesaid man having, I think, displeased you by preventing you from giving sacred vessels and vestments to your relatives. Which case, both I and my predecessor of holy memory have wished to investigate in person. This will not do. We admonish you to restore him as archdeacon. If my command cannot settle things, we have instructed him to submit himself to us in person and bid your love send us someone au courant with the case, so that with both present, we may, with God's help, decide the matter. Deacon Honoratus, that is what I shall call you, for that is what you are, your promotion having been against your will. I have read the contradictory letters which you and your bishop have addressed to us against each other, and we grieve that there is so little charity between you. Nevertheless, we enjoin you that if the cause of offense between you can be settled graciously, without further ado, we believe it will greatly advantage both your souls. If this cannot be, if no peace can be made, come without delay to make your case, and let your bishop send a representative so that we can consider and settle it. But be assured, we shall make strict inquiry of you on all points as to whether the ornaments of the church are where they ought to be, for if any are found to have been lost through another's dishonesty, you as well will have to answer for it. For as archdeacon, you have final responsibility for the care of the church's goods.
Holy Father, I am deeply saddened to report that the state of things has not improved. My Lord Bishop occupies himself wholly in parties and feasts, living a life of luxury unbecoming to a servant of God's people. He has also neglected the sacred duties of his office and devotes little or no time to the study of Holy Scripture. He has, moreover, done nothing to restore me to my office, nor arrange for a way for you to hear the case in person. I appeal to you, therefore, to take some more direct action as pastor of pastors and bishop of bishops.
My dear, dear brother bishop and father in God, I'm crushed, simply crushed, by the tone of your recent communication to my poor self. I really am, and I deeply regret having been unable to arrange for someone to represent me before your excellency, to address the malicious reports received from Honoratus. They are a mixture of truth and falsehood, a veritable cocktail of honey mixed with gall. For while it is true that I feast, I invite many to my table. My grounds for feasting stem from a pure and pious heart. I feast and welcome guests in imitation of Abraham, whom Holy Writ attests entertained three angels. How can I know what angels may be dining at my table? And I all unaware of their presence. Dare I reject such a possibility? And recall again, my dear fraternity, how the patriarch Isaac gave his blessing to his son Jacob when he was well satiated by the savory food he loved so much, that his wife Rebekah prepared for him, and so bestowed a fulsome blessing upon his son from a full stomach.
My brother, we will be far from blaming your blessedness for feasting if you can certify that you have, in fact, entertained angels. I urge you to send along a feather from an angelic wing as a token of proof and we shall be satisfied that you have had visitors such as dined with Abraham. Seriously, my brother, you must surely understand that your examples from Genesis, while historical, are meant to instruct us by allegory. We read of things done historically so as to take thought for what is to be done spiritually. Here, as I discern it, is the spiritual meaning of these texts. Recall that Abraham saluted the three angels in the singular, Ne transeas servum tuum, do not pass by thy servant. And in doing so, he declared the persons of the Trinity to be one substance. Further, Isaac blessed his son when full, because one who is filled with divine sustenance acts as a prophet. The word of God is food better than bread. So if you dine on scripture after a mystical fashion, you will be satisfied. Harvest in the field of its words and fill the stomach of your soul so as to be able to pronounce the blessing on the allegorical sum placed before you, to wit, those people in your charge.
My beloved brother, I rejoice in your gift of untangling the hidden allegorical meaning of scripture, a skill for which you are renowned the world over, at least as far as Dalmatia. I know as well that it is your practice to be given too much to fasting. Yet truth is, not all have the same calling. I have a calling to dine rather than to abstain. A vocation to feasting, not fasting. And I hope you know I take but little pleasure in it. Only from the hard words directed at me because of it. It pains me to be called a glutton, to be charged with being a wine bibber. Yet even these accusations, I rejoice with my Lord that I share in his trials in this regard. I willingly bear this cross to be slandered, as was he, accused as a glutton and a drunkard with these self-same words when the people compared him with the abstemious Baptist.
Your blessings. I can assure you, you will never be mistaken for a Baptist. You say that you rejoice with our Lord to be called a glutton. And if you were called so falsely, you would truly bear that name with our Lord, for he was no glutton. But if the charge be true of you, as I hear it is, who can doubt but that it was false of him? I beseech God with all the prayers I can offer that not only the name but the fact may join your most holy fraternity to our Lord.
But, my truly blessed and pious brother, surely you must know that my feasts are not for myself alone. They are the means by which I exercise the ministry of charity, sharing the abundance of my table.
Feasts that truly proceed from charity are known by more than the guest list, but by certain signs, when the lives of those absent from the table are not backbitten, and no one is ridiculed, and no idle tales or worldly talk are heard but the words of sacred reading, when the body is not pampered with more than is needful, but only the weakness refreshed, that it may be kept in health for the practice of virtue. If, then, you so conduct yourself in your feasts, I own that you are a master of abstinence.
In all humility, may I remind you, eminent servant of servants, that Holy Writ teaches us in the testimony of the Apostle, let not him that eateth not judge him that eateth. You, my Lord, are renowned for your abstinence. Heaven forbid you should fall under the charge of judging your brother, my poor self, for doing that from which you refrain.
This charge is out of place, for I am not one that eateth not, for I do eat, but in moderation. And also because Paul did not mean by this that the members of Christ's body, the church, should have no care for each other in bearing each other's burdens. And as faults are burdens, how is a brother to relieve them but by pointing them out? If, indeed, I had nothing to do with you, nor you with me.
Don't I wish.
I should rightly be compelled to hold my peace, lest I should blame one whom I could not manage. But the apostle's precept was given against people who judge those not committed to their care, meddlesome fault finders in other people's business. But we, by the grace of God, as servant of servants, are established in an office of care and service for all the churches. And we should be wrong to pass over in silence what calls for correction. For what greater service is there but to correct those who wander to their own destruction? Your fraternity dislikes it that I have called you to account for feasts, while I, your superior in position, not in worthiness, welcome and endure the criticisms of all, seeking my own amendment thereby. I welcome criticism, as you should too. Not only for such are willing to be corrected, are their true friends, through whose chastisement we cleanse our souls before the arrival of the ultimate judge.
Dear brother and bishop, your words are hard, and though I take them to heart, I must say that you add to my tribulations thereby. It is on account of these and like troubles that I find I have so little time or inclination to devote myself to the study of Holy Scripture. For to a troubled heart and full of tribulation, even honey is bitter. Moreover, I say this in all humility, I find it more to my taste and talents not to spend many weary hours in study for preparing my sermons, but instead to preach ex tempore, as our Lord counseled, take no thought how or what you shall speak, for it shall be given you in that hour what you shall speak. I humbly submit my obedience is to a higher power, not your own eminent self in this regard.
Most sweet brother. Tribulations are no excuse for being unable to find time to read. The apostle teaches that whatsoever is written in Scripture is for our comfort and hope. Thus, we ought to find all the more time to read in tribulation. And as to abandoning study to rely on the Holy Spirit in preaching, I say that the Holy Scriptures have been given in vain if, being filled with the Spirit, we have no need of them. Surely, dearest brother, trust in the Spirit to testify in time of persecution is one thing. What we ought to preach when the church is at peace is another. For it is our duty through this same Spirit to learn by reading in time of peace what we may be able to recount in time of suffering, should cause arise.
Dear Holy Father, you must pardon my blushes when I say that many members of my church, and not only my own people, but a number of heretics and unbelievers, have been swayed by my little sermons. As I hasten to add, dear brother of mine, I know both things are true of your preaching and writing, which you, by dint of diligent labor and much toil, bring forth to such praise, while I am able to do the same by inspiration, with little effort, to God alone the glory. But we are very different, the two of us. In temperament, you are naturally as studious as you are abstemious, whereas I am a creature of more nimble wit, and, I admit it, loath to abandon the comforts afforded by the station to which by God's grace I have come. Let me simply say, I know my place, and do not presume above my station.
I rejoice exceedingly that you are giving attention to exhortation, fulfilling the duties of your position, and taking pains to draw others to our Lord. But your saying at the same time that you are not like me saddens me at once, after I had begun to rejoice, since I think that it is in derision that you give me praises, which in truth I do not recognize as due. However, I give thanks to Almighty God that your preaching is recalling heretics to Holy Church. But have a care that those already in her bosom live not as her adversaries through their evil lives, with hearts set not on heavenly things, but earthly lusts and pleasures. Finally, and this saddens me more than I can say, but say it I must, I understand that you have not since done anything in the matter of restoring Honoratus to his office as archdeacon. Two pontiffs have now expressly enjoined this action and called upon you to send a representative for trial of the case. Wherefore, let your fraternity, even after repeated admonition, repent of the error of your wrongdoing and restore the aforesaid Honoratus to his post immediately. If you defer any longer, know that your use of the pallium granted to you by a former occupant of this see is taken from you. And should you, even after losing the pallium, still persist in disobedience, you shall be deprived of participation in the body and blood of the Lord. Furthermore, it will then be my sad duty to inquire more fully into the charges against you, and to consider with the utmost care and investigation whether you should even retain your episcopate. Moreover, the man whom you unjustly promoted in place of Honoratus is hereby deposed from the archdeaconry. And should he dare to continue in that ministry, let him know he too is deprived of participation in Holy Communion. It pains me greatly that things should come to this pass, and I look forward to word of your reformation and submission. I had rather win you by persuasion than with the use of the power at my disposal. But you have brought this on yourself.
Oh, my dear Father in God, oh, this is too much. The pallium, as you know, was granted to my humble self by your predecessor of sacred memory, and I would do nothing to imperil a tradition of the Church. I am a traditionalist, I admit it, say what you may. And as to the pallium itself, well, it suits me, it really does. Many people have told me so. And excommunication, perish the thought that such a word should pass your doubly holy lips. Blessed both with the reception of the sacrament and, usually, by the utterance of such profound and sweet, comfortable preaching. Nonetheless, let it be known that I shall restore the often aforementioned Honoratus to his office as archdeacon, fully restore all the rights and privileges of that ministry. I am sending messengers to set all the information before you. I sincerely hope we will need no more hard words on that subject. It has been most distressing to me, and the whole affair has put me right off my food. This awful heartburn. And so it is with a warm heart. I send you these closing words, my dear, dear fellow bishop, for all of your solicitous care and concern for the good of my soul.
Dear brother bishop, it pleases me no end that you have repented of a thing that if any one of the four patriarchs had done, such insolence could not have been allowed to pass without offense.
Nevertheless, now that your fraternity has returned all to its proper position, I do not harbor in mind the wrong done either to myself or to my predecessor. That ship has sailed. As to tradition, far be it from me to infringe in any church on the rulings of our ancestors in regard to my fellow bishops, since I do myself an injury if I disturb the rights of my brethren. And when your messengers arrive, I shall know firsthand of the case between you and Honoratus, and my personal examination will prove to you that, if you have justice on your side, you will sustain no injury from me, as indeed you never have done. Concerning the talk of excommunication, which, if I may say so, it was a painful necessity to invoke, your blessedness complains unreasonably, since the Apostle Paul says, I am ready to punish disobedience until obedience is achieved. But let these things pass. Let us return to what concerns us now. For as you promise to do as you should, I cannot but be friends with you, knowing how much I am a debtor to your affection and appreciate your prayers. I have been much distressed concerning you, my brother and fellow bishop and metropolitan, having experienced your proud behavior. But since you have come to yourself and corrected your manners, you have overcome me and comforted my sadness.
Holy Father, it is my sad duty to report the passing into holy memory of my former bishop, Natalis. Shortly after an exceptionally festive banquet. We are bereaved, but not surprised. But it pleases me to inform your beatitude that the clergy and people of Salona have chosen your humble servant, myself, to succeed Bishop Natalis of blessed memory and to take up the office of Archbishop and Metropolitan. Allow me to take this opportunity to express my thanks to you, Holy Father, for your patience and care in how you have guided our poor province in a wholesome direction. God be praised.
Amen. Amen.